Hello, Hans. Welcome in. Thank you for coming to talk to us about this big new publishing revolution that's going on. But let's talk first about your book, London's Burning: An Exploration in Punk Subculture. How did you come to write this?
Well, it was my BA thesis at the University of Antwerp in Belgium. And I carried it around for 30 years. It was written in 1980. It was never published, only photocopied, underground style, punk style, and distributed by myself at the time. But it was never in electronic form. It was never in English. So the market was very limited. So when I came to New Zealand, I didn't really know what to do with it, because it was just sitting there. And my friends asked me, when can we read it? So I thought, well, maybe I should start looking at translating it and publishing it in some form. And with the whole new internet publishing, distribution, easy way of doing things, it opened up an avenue to actually do it all myself and doing it in punk style, keep the ethic going of do it yourself.
Well,
So
very punk and rebellious do-it-yourself publishing. And so
yes.
we'll get on to the publishing, but just for a moment to talk about punk. What was it like in London then in 1980? It must have been just amazing.
Well, I wasn't actually in London because I studied in Antwerp.
But you visited a lot, I gather, as you were doing
Yeah,
this.
it wasn't easy to visit because you couldn't go on the Eurostar like you can now, or cheap
Or
airfare. So
Ryanair or anything like
no,
that. No,
it
would have
was
been
very
quite.
expensive to even to travel across the channel. So it was all very rarely I could go, and I went for an extended time to do a summer school course at the local university, and then have some forays into the nightlife.
And on the back of the book, there's this fabulous photograph of you as you were then.
Yes, young and innocent.
Young and innocent, yes. So were you quite wide-eyed about what you were seeing? I mean, was it pretty special?
Well, I was really involved in the music scene and in the DJ scene and in publishing fanzines at the time, but also from an academic perspective, I wanted to do this for my sociology degree, and the university let me, so that was really nice of them.
All right, now let's move on to the stuff that all the would-be writers out there want to know, because I know that there are, because I do writing courses too, I know how many people are thinking, oh, but you know, it's so hard to get published now by a mainstream publisher, but what if I want to do just 20 of these or 100 of them, or what if it's just a family history that I want to spread around the family, or might there be people who are in the market for my children's book or whatever? So here you were with an old manuscript that you must have had to retype
Yes.
and translate because it was in the wrong language.
Yes.
And you had to digitize it.
Yes.
So then what?
Well, Amazon.com, which is a really a big distributing company, has a publishing arm called createspace.com. And they allow you to publish your own book in whatever format, size, typeface, the cover design. It's all up to you. So the difficult thing is to actually getting it there in the right format for them to be able to publish it as a book.
So as a writer, the best your best way to start is to go to createspace.com
Yes.
and just read what's there. Yes.
Set
All
up
the
an
helpful tips.
set up an account. You don't have to do anything if you don't want to publish, but you can go through the whole process, and they give you help every step of the way. They give you advice. They even email you if you ask them questions, which I found really amazing that such a big company would do that for you. There is also a whole community spirit there, all authors who've been through the process, who can give advice on how to go about
I'm
it.
amazed. You imagine Amazon to be this huge, vast, amorphous American sort of conglomerate who wouldn't care less. So that's really interesting.
It's because you,
But of course they're making money from
yes,
you, hopefully.
they reckon that they can then sell your book online in a variety of formats, but as a print book, as for Kindle, and probably in the future for other platforms as well.
So Kindle's quite small in New Zealand so far. There aren't that many people who have them or an iPad or,
No.
you know, a decent sized tablet to read on.
Yes.
But it's huge in America and in other more advanced Western countries, you could say. And it's inevitable that it's going to be here too, isn't it? I mean, a
Sure.
Kindle's just a thing this size. It's
Yes.
very lightweight, easy to carry, pop in your bag, you can put 5,000 books on it. And so that's the way of the future, isn't it?
It depends on, on the type of book you have, because mine has got some pictures, and it's a little bit grayscaley, so the pictures don't come out all right, but I don't have a Kindle myself, but I have published it on Kindle as well, and there are programs that allow you to preview what it looks like on Kindle, and the pictures didn't come out that well, but I have a friend who has a Kindle, and she downloaded it on the Waiheke ferry immediately, and she could show me what the book looks like. That's just fantastic.
Amazing, isn't it? So A, it's on Kindle. B, you can go and you could buy that if you wanted to read it, or if anyone wants to look at it, via Amazon.com.
Yes.
But through their printing arm that you've accessed through CreateSpace, people can buy an actual hard copy, lovely old-fashioned book.
Yes.
And so this is print on demand, is
yes.
it?
Yes.
It only gets printed
when
somebody
order
goes online and pays their $9.99. $19.99.
$19.99.
I'm sorry, and it gets printed and then popped in an envelope and sent to you, and within a couple of weeks or something.
Oh, probably really fast, because Amazon works quite fast in their delivery. Yes,
and that's not all you've done, is it? You have a New Zealand publishing arm as well, handling it.
Mm. Yes, I found a company here in New Zealand who wants to do the e-book publishing outside the Kindle system for your you could even read it on your phone or on your PC or on your tablet or your iPad.
Or would it work on the one that Witkles sells, which is called the Kobo, I think?
I don't know.
I mean, there are so many of these things. Yes.
I think the e-book is not tied to a specific hardware format.
Right.
So it's readable by any device that you
so
want to download.
So that's as a PDF, is it?
Yes.
Right. So you would have to send your book, you would have to put your chunk your book into nice pages in individual PDFs.
Yes.
And send
them.
No.
The content is one PDF.
Oh, okay.
The same for the print version.
Mm.
For Kindle, it's a Word document.
Okay.
They want, as a format.
So that local company is wheelers.co.nz.
Yes. That's right.
Mm.
I got onto them via the Auckland Library because I wanted to have my book stocked in schools and libraries, because it's an academic work rather than a romance novel. And they advised me to go via a company that they plug into to get where they get their books from.
An established distributor, which Wheelers is. Yes.
So they demand their cut, but then, you know, everybody does.
So this sounds like an awful lot of work. Has it been an awful lot of work, or has it actually fallen into place much more easily than you thought it might?
Because it required transcribing, translating, and then publishing. It took about 12 months.
Right.
But if you got your book ready, it can go within weeks. And then it's up to you to actually promote it, because that's the main task after you publish it, is to make people aware that
it's all about the marketing, isn't it?
Yes. So it has its Facebook page.
Yes.
I publish it regularly, and when people ask me and
And you did your own launch party, so that the people in your immediate circle knew that it was happening.
Yes, and then you could sign copies, because the disadvantage is, if people buy books from you, you can't sign them.
Yes.
But you have to do a social event to do that, so that's always
indeed
fun.
Yes. Well, although some people, for instance, Wendell Nissen, who we've had on this show a lot, I mean, she publishes her own books, and she organises her own author tour and goes around bookshops and gives a little talk and signs things. And so there are lots of different ways in which writers can do their marketing.
Yes, if you don't have a proper publisher that organises it all for you, you have to do that yourself, unfortunately.
It's an amazing time, this, isn't it? I mean, this must be the biggest time in writing and publishing since Gutenberg was a boy, really, when he invented movable type. And when was it, the 1500s or something?
Yes.
People didn't have to have hand-done beautiful manuscripts. They could actually print things over and over and over and over again the same way. That was vast, and it's taken 500 years, really, to get to this point again, hasn't it?
Yes.
It's
a step up, because also your book is never out of print now.
Mm.
It is always there, unless you withdraw it from CreateSpace or from Amazon.
Yes.
It will be there forever.
I guess one disadvantage of something like this is that you will probably never get it reviewed in local newsprint or magazines or whatever, because they tend to ignore self-published books. You know, they'd prefer to get them from Random or Penguin or whoever. So that's a bit of a downside with the self-publishing.
It depends on the subject. Yes. Because I had the Herald interview me, and I was in
There you are. I'm all wrong. Well done. Yes.
So it's up to, you know.
Yeah, so that's all about marketing again, isn't it?
Yes,
saying, look, I've got this really interesting and different book. Yes.
Sure. But it is content-based. Mm. If the subject is interesting for a journalist, they will pick it up if it's just a run-of-the-mill romance novel.
Oh, well,
not that I want to denigrate that, but it's more difficult to generate interest.
Yes, but I congratulate you. That's good.
Thank you very much.
But you know, but those run-of-the-mill romance novels too. I mean, some people in America, I understand, are literally becoming millionaires by doing potboiler romances and selling them for 99 cents on Amazon. So the field is vast, isn't it? Everything from being this all about punk subculture and all of its wonderful roaring ways, to something that's a really run-of-the-mill romance. I mean, it's all catered for, isn't it?
Sure,
all online.
And your own creativity is the limit, basically.
Yes, that's right. So this should be a really great time for creativity in the world.
Yes, so it should, because we're in a crisis.
We are. Yes, we need that. Yes. Thank you so much, Hans.
Thank you very much.